Police were called within 15 minutes, but they didn't arrive for nearly an hour. It took them another 2 hours before they bothered to seal off Madeleine's bedroom. British investigators later called it the worst preserved crime scene they'd ever encountered. Roadblocks and checks weren't put on Portugal's borders for a full 12 hours. And within days, hundreds of guests, potential witnesses and suspects had checked out and left without ever having been interviewed.
Now, I can't defend what the police did or didn't do. I don't know it. I didn't work with them. I have no association with them. But I do ask your viewing audience to consider that it is very possible that the initial investigators didn't believe they needed to do any of those things.
Yeah.
I'd like you to consider this. I know exactly where that table was. And then he stumbles over to exactly where the table was. Why would he give such an unnecessary detail? Why would we care where the table was located? In resisting interrogations, Navy SEALs use a tactic. If an enemy takes a Navy SEAL, the Navy SEAL is taught to resist the interrogation by giving enough truthful details of something irrelevant to satisfy the interrogators. Mm. And so a Navy SEAL is captured, and he talks about how he dives and cleans the ship. And he gives such details that the interrogators think, this idiot is someone's job is just to clean the ship, and he's going on and on about every detail of what how he does it and how long he's underwater, what tools he uses. Nothing to find here. Jerry shows a stronger or a more efficient level of sophistication and deception in this manner. This is, in fact, what you had mentioned earlier in your question. This is a form of diversion. He is safely going in to describe a table, because that's a safe thing to say. We call this leakage. He knows what happens, or I'll say it this way. The brain knows what happened. He now has to go into the brain and talk about what happened, but not give it away. It's really difficult because he might choose some of the wrong words by accident. So he focuses on a table, and then he stumbles on it because it's such a ridiculous point. He's using a diversion tactic because it's necessary. So what we do is we say, well, here's a diversion tactic. Why would the dad of a missing little girl need to make such effort to divert attention away from what happened?
The night seemed so long. Every second was excruciating, and it was dark, and he just wanted to be light and everybody searching, and Madeleine found.
Okay, this particular statement itself is very concerning. First of all, we'd ask the question, for whom was this night so long and so excruciating for? For Kate. Or if we want to listen to her words, it was not even for Kate, it was for you. Listen to what she says. Believe what she says. The night seemed so long, every second was excruciating, and it was dark, and you just want there to be light. Not she, not her as a mother. But by the way, was it excruciating for Madeleine to be taken? She shows concern for you or herself and nothing for the child. A parental instinct is so powerful that we've used it in judicial courts since time out of mind. Going back to the Solomonic courts of your Bible lessons, where two women gave birth to children, and one woman rolled over and suffocated the child. And they each claimed custody of the living child. Neither wanted custody of the dead child. And it went all the way to Solomon's court. And people who know the story said, Solomon said, bring me a sword, cut the living child in half, and give them each half their baby. Solomon had no intention of committing murder. What Solomon had done was repeated both women's arguments. The woman who actually gave birth to the child said, let her, the liar, have the child. Let my child live. And everyone was able to see that's really the mother. He was exploiting maternal instinct. Prior to that, he simply repeated their arguments. And if we listen very carefully, especially as it comes out in Hebrew, it's very simple. This mother says, the dead child is hers, the living child is mine. She mentioned the dead child first. That's what people do. They mention their own first. But this mother says, no, the living child is mine, the dead child is hers. She mentioned the living child first because that's her child. When no one understood that, when no one was listening to the order of which someone spoke, then Solomon called for the sword and said, cut the baby in half and give them each half, without any intention of murder. The maternal instinct came forward, everyone knew. They would have known before the sword was taken if they just listened to each mother. So I ask you to listen to this mother, and listen to her carefully. The night seemed so long, for whom? Every second was excruciating, for whom? It was dark, and you just want there to be light. Okay, let's find out what you want. Let's look at the order. You want there to be light, you want everybody searching, and you want Madeleine found. Her priority is light for you, everybody searching, and Madeleine found. Madeleine is the last thing in her priority. As a matter of fact, this statement shows that someone was living in excruciating pain. Someone was living in excruciating length of time, impatience. But here is where we expect her to show what Madeleine is going through. Where is her teddy bear? Where is her favorite blanket? Where is her favorite toy? Not a single word of concern. Now, why would she give last in her priority Madeleine being found? I ask your audience to consider, she doesn't want Madeleine found. Any parent, innocent parent, would want that first and foremost. She instead turns the lights, and that would be more further insight psychologically into their own thinking. But her order tells us that the last in her priority is having Madeleine found. We also see that the emotion that's used is narrative, but it's also focused towards her. However, in the pronoun you, even that she doesn't take ownership of. I think it was an excruciating night, and I think that her concern for herself is genuine, because this is what I'm building towards. Mm-hmm. There's no concern for Madeleine by a biological mother and by a biological father, because Madeleine is dead. Madeleine is beyond concern. Madeleine is beyond help. There's no more fretting or worrying for Madeleine. And that's what's in this statement. Mm-hmm. Is Madeleine crying? Does she have her favorite teddy bear? Is she getting her meds? Is she calling out for me, the mother? Is Madeleine in excruciating pain? What must Madeleine be experiencing in the hands of strangers? These are all things that were not in their language.
Yeah.
And this is consistent. This is not just one interview. These people have always been focused upon themselves. They have always given an indication that Madeleine will not be found alive, if found at all, and that Madeleine being found is not something they want to happen. Mm-hmm. Their concern is always for themselves, because Madeleine doesn't need concern any longer. The past tense reference is one thing that indicates death, but this is the most powerful part of the analysis, is that they're telling us Madeleine is dead. Now, I know that people wondered if there was a kidnapping, if they were sold into sex rings, child sex rings, and these things do exist. That's not what's in the parents' language. So I can only say what's in that language, and I'm letting them guide me. I'm letting them dictate to me my opinion by the words that they're choosing. And they're actually going to give us more detail. Mm-hmm. Richard, they're going to confess.
You think so? Oh, you mean in the subtext of the interview? You don't mean literally, do you?
In this statement, we're going to see what we call a statement analysis confession. They right. actually admit it to us what happened.
Did you kill your daughter?
No. That's an emphatic no. I mean, the ludicrous thing is what's been purported from Portugal is that Madeleine died in the apartment by an accident and we hid her body. Well, when did she have the accident and died? Because the only time she was left unattended was when we were at dinner. So if she died then, how could we have disposed or hidden her body, you know, when there was an immediate search? It's just nonsense. So, and if she died when we were in the apartment or fell and did, why would we cover that up?
And this is what we call the embedded confession. This is where a guilty party will put together in their own language what happened. And we need to listen and believe them. We also have the principle of them asking questions. This is very important. They're asking questions to find out how their answers will be responded to. Will it be ridicule? Would it be acceptance? Will it sound sane? Will it help get them off the hook? Listen very carefully to what they say. It's a yes or no question. Did you kill your daughter? No is a good answer. And what I teach investigators to do is when someone is asked a yes or no question is to count on their fingers the number of words following the word no. No. That's an emphatic no. And obviously it goes into the point where it goes beyond your 10 fingers. When it goes that long, very simply speaking, there is a need to persuade. So the no is not going to stand on itself. If he said, no, I didn't kill my daughter and I'm telling you the truth, this would be something very strong. Then we'd have to ask about her. And we'd also have to ask, did something cause your daughter's death? That sort of thing. But here, no, that's an emphatic no. The first thing we know about his denial is that his denial, from his perspective, needs some help. It's weak. That's an emphatic no. So the first thing is no, okay, an emphatic no. My no needs emphasis. Why does it need to be emphasis? Is one. I mean, the ludicrous thing is what I suppose what's been purported from Portugal is that Madeleine died in the apartment by accident and we hid her body. Okay. What he tells us here is Madeleine died in the apartment, his words, by an accident, which would support the pronoun we that we heard between mother and child, and we hid her body. I believe him. The reason I say this is an embedded confession is because he is not entering any other language. He's not quoting anyone. For instance, if I said, well, you said that I killed her, that's not an embedded confession because I'm actually quoting you. Here, he's not only is he not quoting anyone, he's only saying what's been purported, not even an accusation. And we need to be listening to him. This now tells me, as an analyst, Madeleine died in the apartment. So I know from their language thus far that Madeleine is not alive. They are in need of an alibi. The death was not intended. And the location of the death is in the apartment. And again, by accident. And then I know something else now. I know that we hid the body. Jerry and his wife, the two McCanns together, they worked together to hide her body. Then he goes into questions. And this is where guilty parties are looking to see what a response is. They want, they're disguised as rhetorical questions, but they want to see what people respond to them as. This takes place even in the interview process. Well, when did she have the accident and died? Okay, what they want to know is, do people know the exact time of death? Because the only time she was left unattended, is not the only time we left her. He's now removing himself from that. Left unattended is passive. Was when we, which shows unity between him and his wife, were at dinner. So if she died then, which this is, we call this an allowance, the father of a missing child is allowing for a scenario that denial will not allow. There's no natural denial. He's saying if she died then, not even if she was dead, which is itself a red flag, but now about a specific time, how could we have disposed, hidden her body? The word disposed and then hidden, the change there, actually shows respect for Madeleine. It's a softer terminology. Not dump the body, and he even changes dispose, a self-correction from disposed to hidden. He now tells us that they didn't dispose the body, they actually hid it. This is why, and this confirms the priority, we want there to be light, we want there to be searching. By the way, we also want them to find Madeleine, but it's last on my list of priorities. So I now know that Madeleine is dead, Madeleine died in the apartment, and listen to his questions. When did we do this? How did we do this? You know, when there's an immediate It's just nonsense, self-censoring again. And if she died when we were in the apartment, or fell and died, why would we cover that up? Okay, that's the most important question he asks. So he now introduces something else that may have happened. Madeleine fell. I am concerned and remain concerned that Madeleine may have been drugged in any way, shape, or form, whether it be nighttime cough syrup or something more, so that these people could go and have their dinner and their party and get their break and all that, that Madeleine awoke and fell and got injured, and the injury was beyond.
Yeah. Can I just interject with a question, Peter?
Sure.
When he's saying, he's alluding to the fact that he doesn't think they would have had time on that particular evening to deal with the body. Could that suggest that there's been pre-planning and the meal was orchestrated to allow for a window for their phantom abductor? And he's confident that he can show the audience that there's not enough time for them to have done that. So in other words, it's possibly happened on a previous time.
Yes, it is possible. And this, the focus on time, which he doubles up on, opens that door up now for us.
Right.
We have to consider it. Intention, it hasn't changed. In other words, that this death was not intended is not changed by this. But the fact that they do, or he does, in his language, focus so much on time, we must now be open to the possibility that he has a confidence about this time frame because it happened at a different time frame. So the answer is yes.
Okay.
What he's doing is he's affirming every other point of analysis. So when I said earlier that we look at little point here, little point there, he's now summed it up for us. The reason why this father does not show any concern about what Madeleine is going through is because Madeleine is beyond experiencing anything that he would need to be concerned about. They hid her body.
Right.
That's what they did, according to his language. But I don't think we should dismiss quickly that he introduced falling. Mm-hmm. She was very tired, Kate said. Mm-hmm. They had left her for their own. And so he asked the question, why would we cover this up? Mm-hmm. And the answer is quite simple. We have professional people who have two other children, an unintentional death. You're going to lose custody of the children.
Another motive might be if there had been signs of abuse.
Yes.
That would come up in the hospital.
In the inquiry, sure.
Yeah.
As a medical professional, in any way, they are very likely to have knowledge of child abuse because it's just part of that profession where they deal with that. Now, we have some indications there that would need much further exploration for possible sexual abuse. And there is a risk of the consequences for an unintended death, that's number one, risk of losing the other children, number two, and then as you point out, when Child Protective Services sends in a professional to investigate, every case is explored for sexual abuse, whether there's allegations or not. All indicators of all possible abuses are explored for. Neglect, physical abuse, emotional abuse, sexual abuse are going to be explored for in every case. Because we have some linguistic indicators, which could be them as parents, it could be them as abusers, it could be him as an abuser, it could be her failure to protect, we have to explore for it.
Right.
The consequences could go on more than just losing custody of the twins.
Mm-hmm.
It could be loss of freedom.
Yeah.
When a guilty person asks questions, they're floating out alibis, they're looking to see what sounds plausible, and in his question, he says, well, when did she have the accident, not a accident, the accident, and died? The only time she was left unattended was when we were at dinner, so, which is establishing his alibi, if she died then, how could we have disposed of hidden her body? Now, it's interesting, when some people ask questions like that, they don't always get the answers they want to hear. We have here in the United States a baseball player who was accused of using performance-enhancing drugs, named Roger Clemens. And under oath, he said, If I have all these performance-enhancing drugs, it would mean that someone supplied them. Who is this? Who supplied them? I wish he would come forward. So he asked who supplied them, and then he made a wish. The man who supplied him with the performance-enhancing drugs came forward and fulfilled his wish and testified against him. So by asking a question, they're trying to portray it as if it's not plausible while they're giving out information and admitting what happened. This is an embedded confession in statement analysis. This is not the quote of someone else accusing them. This is what was purported to come out from Portugal. What he's saying to you is Portugal police know. So they may make various statements, but the investigators on the ground, if we were to talk to them, the ones that first responded, they would tell you exactly what they feel about this case, and I think it would be right here, that it's a cover-up.
And that gets even more ludicrous, that we've obviously hidden it somewhere incredibly well where nobody's found it.
I believe what she's telling me. I believe that, first of all, the word obvious means to accept without question, and I am following it. That we've obviously, it's obvious to, and this is a concern of hers, that people recognize they've hidden her somewhere incredibly well where nobody's found her. Now, consider this. This is supposed to be from a mother of a missing child who is spending a lot of time defending herself, trying to ridicule the accusations, instead of pleading for her safe return and talking about what she's going through. Again, there is no concern for what Madeleine is going through by biological parents, close relatives, the closest relatives.
Incredibly well. And it headed so well that we then decided we'd move her in the car, which we hired weeks later. And, you know, it's just ridiculous.
So now we have a change of language from ludicrous to ridiculous. We have a car entering her language. And the timing is not lost on us either. She now says weeks later. So if someone was concerned that the death took place at a different time, she's now saying, you've got a good idea to be concerned about that. She's playing with the time. Mm-hmm. So to narrow down the time frame to what they want us to think it is would not be a wise investigatory move. We'd have to be open to other time here.
Does that include the death occurring before their stated time, the time they say Madeleine was abducted?
It has to go beyond the time that they state. It has to,
right.
because their words are guiding, at least from my perspective as a statement analyst, they're not locking in a time frame. Mm-hmm. By choosing 3 weeks is to deliberately blur. It's kind of a joke, but it's a statistical point, is that when someone is going to choose a number and they need to lie about it, they often will cling to number 3. Mm-hmm. 2 sounds too small, 4 sounds too big, and it's one of those statistical patterns.
They did hire a car after they'd reported her missing, a few weeks after.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what she's referring to there. And there was evidence found in the car.
Yes.
Of a cat of a dog evidence, mm-hmm. I believe.
Yep. The point being is that as she even goes to this area, she's changing the time frame for us.
Right.
So even if 3 is accurate, right, it's still fascinating that she is now moving the time away from what they originally said.
Right.
So it's sensitive to her.
Right, I see.
When you come back to Portugal, do you feel closer to Madeleine?
And although I don't know where Madeleine is, that is the last place that, you know, I saw her and held her, and I guess there's a part of me that still feels connected to her there. So.
This was an interesting question, and I thought, for an interview that I did not think very highly of, this was a fascinating question that grabbed my attention. And I think the interviewer might be probing for what we actually get here. Is her answer is important. Although I don't know where Madeleine is, no one accused you of that. So before she even gets to her emotion, she has a need to deny that she knows where Madeleine is. You know what that tells me? She knows where Madeleine is.
Right.
That she's actually affirming that we hid her incredibly well. These two smart people who were in panic mode for themselves hid her incredibly well. So although I don't know where Madeleine is, we call that the negation. She wants us to know what She doesn't know. Very sensitive. And then she uses the phrase, you know. And what we do with any type of habit of speech is we look where it comes up and where it doesn't come up. And it shows an acute awareness of the interviewer. So we notice what topics will provoke that, what topics do not provoke it. And about the location of Madeleine, it provoked it. Then she says, and I think this is important, I saw her, held her. Now, in order to hold her, you have to see her. Seeing her is unnecessary. People speak that way about dead people, about dead family members. Because in order to hold her, you have to see her, unless you held a dead body. I think that when Madeleine's lifeless body was carried, Kate held her. I think she's telling the truth.
I think kids can be written off. You know, missing kids can be written off too easily. You cannot do that. You cannot give up on a child.
This is the mother of a missing child, utterly avoiding the call to find her child, utterly avoiding the call to attention of what Madeleine is suffering through. Instead, this is extreme distancing. I don't want Madeleine written off. I want her found. No, kids, general, can be written off. You know, again, that awareness of the interviewer. Missing kids, no, my Madeleine. Missing kids can be written off. This is someone who has well moved beyond in the grieving stage. She has well processed the information. Madeleine's not coming home, and she is at peace with it now. This is a distancing language of kids, child. The use of the word child there again is something that, you know, we don't say kid abuser, kid molester. We say child abuse, child molester. This use of the word child, although it's not conclusory by itself, with the other indicators, causes me to be concerned that Madeleine was a victim of child abuse inside that home. I don't know for certain. There are certain things that I do and can say that with a strong conclusion. That's an element that must be explored.
Right. Just as an aside, Peter, are you aware of what we call the Gasper statements? This was statements that a family or a couple made against the McCanns not long after it happened. Are you aware of that?
No.
Okay. Oh, perhaps I can show you that at some point. But they had been on holiday with the McCanns about a year earlier, or at a previous time. They were sat around the dinner table, and the wife was in between Jerry and Jerry's friend, and Jerry was discussing with David Payne. He said something like, he actually said, would Madeleine do this? And he put his finger in his mouth and moved it in and out while circling his nipple, okay? Yeah. David Payne said, and Jerry didn't seem fazed by that question.
Yeah.
So after this couple found out...
We're more fazed by the question, my own reaction to that.
Yeah, yeah. So after this couple found out that, you know, that this case was going on, they went to Leicestershire Police and reported this. In fact, they wouldn't allow their child to be bathed by either Jerry or David Payne after they heard this. Because that was another thing, that they've spent time bathing each other's children. Okay, which, I mean, I don't know if that's normal. I don't think it is. Them going to report that in the UK was withheld. The British police didn't send it to the Portuguese police investigation until the lead investigator had been sacked. So that only surfaced, and the Portuguese new investigation team ignored it because we think there's a political decision being made to pull the investigation.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, just a point that there's other statement evidence that Jerry might be involved in abuse, even though you've not even seen that.
Right. The concerns are in the language, and I didn't know that,
right.
But they're in the language. They rely upon an infant's natural sucking mechanism of survival. That's one of the methods of sexual exploitation of a child. So
right.
that motion that he made,
right.
That would certainly fit into the language then.
Kids are survivors.
Jerry says kids are survivors. He doesn't tell us Madeline's a survivor. He follows the same vein. What they're doing is psychologically they're gone. They're distancing themselves from Madeline. That she doesn't exist. And in the statement, and this is why it's so important to consider, it's not just that they show no concern about Madeline. We have to enter into their language. We have to go into their world. The reason they're not concerned about Madeline is because she's beyond concern. She doesn't exist any longer. So it's natural for them to talk about kids being survivors and kids doing this, or you feeling that, or you feeling this, because they've already processed it. Mm-hmm. It's gone.
No, Madeline means tower of strength. Wherever she is, whoever she's been with, whatever's happened, we will get her through it.
Okay, my transcript says, you know, Madeline means tower of strength. Wherever she was, whoever she's been with, whatever's happened, we will get her through it. Several things. She doesn't tell us that Madeline is a tower of strength. She doesn't say that she has any strength. She doesn't show any detailed concern for Madeline. And she says, we will get her through it, which is a form of passivity. After saying Madeline, the name means strength, but we will get her through it. There's a disconnect there in language, which is more narrative storytelling, almost poetic. We'd find that on a card of someone well after death.
You will not rest until you find your daughter, until you wrap your arms around her.
Why do they say such things? As a journalist, why feed information to a subject that way? It makes no sense.
Yeah. I don't believe any parent could, you know, and I don't believe we could ever reach a point where we just think, oh, well, we've done everything now, you know. Whilst the situation remains as it is, you know, Madeline's out there and she needs us to find her. Mm-hmm.
You'll keep looking forever.
We will.
This is, again, another indication that the processing of information has been complete. She tells us what she doesn't believe, tells us what doesn't happen. I don't believe any parent could, and I don't believe we ever could, reach a point, and this is her language, I believe her, we just think, oh, well, we've done everything now, you know. I think that we've hidden her incredibly well. We've done everything now. Her death wasn't intended. We've moved on. So while Madeline's plight, while Madeline's pain, while Madeline's suffering is there, no, while the situation remains, it's a situation. Madeline is no longer part of the picture. There's a situation, and those in situation involved in it are she and her husband. For them, it's a situation. It is not a trauma. This is very soft language. Situation remains. Not Madeline's not been found. And you know, Madeline's out there. Do you notice that she avoids saying anything about the person that has her? Or the people that have her? So not only do we not have any connection, but even if they had been guided by law enforcement, they would be speaking to the kidnappers. They would be seeking to provoke empathy or some reason to bring her back. No, she's just out there in the passive voice. That again is another indication they're not concerned. Madeline's beyond the need of their concern. What's the last thing she says? She needs us to find her. Mm-hmm. You keep looking forever? Okay. And I can't help but wonder if the interviewer thought they're going to be like what we call the O.J. Simpson searching for the real killer. O.J. said he was going to search for the rest of his life for the real killer. He had no confidence it was going to happen any time right. before that.
Right.
Instead of saying we're going to search until she's found, it's just going to be, we'll keep looking, you know, forever.
Yeah. You mention baby Ayla here, Peter, in relation to this. Baby Ayla, A-Y-L-A? Have you mentioned that?
Baby Ayla, not in the interview here, but right. in the analysis.
Right, okay. Do you want to mention that now?
Sure. Baby Ayla was in Waterville, Maine, and she was reported kidnapping by her father. And the father was not cooperating with police, and the family was the mother, because they're not married, was trying to get the father to speak. And she finally told media that the father is not cooperating with police. This got a response from him. Liars are always concerned about their reputation. He said, contrary to rumors floating around out there, I have been cooperating with police. And so with the phrase, rumors floating around out there, is a strong indication that baby's in water. And that's where the searching went on. He had was asked, how did you do on your polygraph? He had been accused of low-level drug dealing, child abuse, other things. He answered, I smoked it. I smoked it. So we give ourselves away by the words that we choose. And there is like a almost like a junior high school student talking about a test. I smoked my math test. It's a missing child. He referenced her in the past tense. He never showed concern at any given time for anything that the child may have been experiencing. All his concern was about himself. This is the same of the McCanns. It's very similar. And when we listen to people and follow their language, and their concern is making sure they ridicule instead of deny any possibility of their involvement, that's what their priority is. But we went through this interview, and not once did I hear a single word of human empathy expressed from Madeleine. Mm-hmm. Not once. Madeleine is the victim. And if the deception was to be believed, someone had Madeleine. And was she wearing a warm coat on a cool night? Anything, even the slightest bit of concern, none of that is in their radar because it's not in their hearts. It's not in their minds. It's not in their minds because they know that Madeleine is beyond all help. What I concluded from just this interview itself is that Madeleine is dead. The death was not intentional. That they have disposed of her remains in a hidden manner of which they feel confident will not be found. The cause of death was likely not intended and may have included both causing her to be very sleepy and a fall. They have feared being accused, their concerns about themselves, and that the time frame that they've given must be questioned. Those are things that I conclude strongly. Now, underneath that is the possibility of sexual abuse being part of this equation is strong. And strong. It would have to be explored, yes.
Right.
Okay. It would have to be explored.
Okay, thanks for that, Peter. Now, I did send you some additional transcripts, but obviously there's a vast amount of work to go through them all, and you've done a fantastic job in analysing this one. Clearly, if we were to go through the vast amount of testimony that they've given, you think the same things would likely come up again and again. Just
I do. I believe that even the things that I have looked at all confirm the analysis. What makes this so strong is that this includes an embedded confession. They actually confessed to what they did. Mm-hmm. And I think we should not discount the word fall, that no one asked them if she fell. It was no part of the interview. He introduced that word. It's very important.
Okay. All right. Is there anything else you want to add about the McCann case before I just ask you a few closing questions, Peter?
Yeah, I think I
can. Okay. Well, thanks very much for that. I in my email to you, I mentioned other subjects, non-criminal subjects. Have you ever considered non-criminal subjects? Because there are a lot of purported conspiracies or cover-ups out there that might not necessarily be criminal, where people could leak out information through statement analysis. So have you ever considered that? Is it?
I mean, professionally or about this case?
In particular, I mean, I mentioned here NASA, which is obviously an organization in America which went to the moon allegedly and have done lots of alleged things, which a lot of people question. Mm-hmm. Something like that, would you consider?
Sure.
Or do you think it might damage, you know, your reputation in terms of criminal investigations?
No. As a matter of fact, I work for businesses in doing employment analysis. Mm-hmm. And so if someone applies for a job and the United States government limits the questions that you're allowed to ask. So what I do for companies is it's legally sound, I will say to a potential hire, please tell me about yourself. And if someone is a thief, they're going to tell me through the lens of statement analysis. So in terms of any other topic out there, if they're statements, we can analyze them. If they're official government releases, we can analyze it because there's a writer or writers behind that. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we have statements from defense attorneys. Defense attorneys will reveal what they believe about their client's guilt or innocence.
Right.
I analyzed, for example, Franklin Delano Roosevelt's statement about the December 7th attack at Pearl Harbor by the Japanese Navy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And he is deceptive about it being a surprise.
Right.
He wasn't truthful.
Really?
Yeah. So it matters, the longer that someone's in analysis, it matters not what the narrative is.
Mm-hmm.
The truth is the truth.
Mm-hmm.
So if it sounds absurd, I can't change that. I am just a scientist of that sense of
mm-hmm.
words.
Mm-hmm.
So if I look at a claim, and if the person intends to deceive, I'll pick it up.
Right.
Now, if the person is wrong, but they believe it, there's no deception there.
Yeah.
It's only their intention to deceive that I can pick up.
Right. I've mentioned it in the notes here. There was a press conference in 1969 when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin allegedly came back from the moon, and it's probably about 70 minutes. And they're speaking freely. They're asked quite open questions about what they experienced. And my feeling is there's a deception going on in there, and they're not being truthful about what they've done on that mission, which I know a lot of, especially, you know, in this country, a lot of Americans, well, there's a lot of Americans don't believe that they went to the moon.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what your feelings are on it, but that would be high on my list of things for you to look at if I was going to ask you to look at other things.
Yes.
Okay.
And it's something to look at to see if they are intending to deceive.
Mm-hmm.
Because in 1969, we look at the context, there is a great deal of fear between the West and the Soviets. And so there was a desire on each part to inflate their scientific knowledge to try to avoid nuclear exchange.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Pretty tense times. So if one of the astronauts is speaking freely, it's very likely I can tell you if he's intending to deceive or not.
Okay. Okay. All right then. And just if people watching this, Peter, want to get involved themselves and become statement analysts, what's your advice?
They must have formal training. As you've seen now through this, that the information on a blog is very short, without much explanation, and without the discipline of formal training, even very intelligent people will go astray. And so maybe they will hit 70% accuracy, but the 30% misses are going to discredit not only themselves, but the science.
Mm.
So we have courses that they take at home, but each course comes with 12 months of support. So they never submit an errant report. You always have someone looking at your work, correcting your work. And if they're wrong, we can go right back and say, here's where it went off.
Right.
And so you can correct it and follow the principles. It isn't as it's made to seem through Hollywood or now through Facebook. There are no magic truth wizards. There are no people that are just born. And Dr. Paul Ekman had studied the micro expressions of people to show how they reveal their emotions by slowing down the video frame by frame. And what that led to was lots of people taking this training of trying to spot that. It doesn't translate into any success in investigations. If you ask me, as a matter of public record, Peter, your conclusion that the McCanns are showing guilty knowledge in the death of Madeleine, how sure are you of that?
Mm-hmm.
I am able to answer that knowing that my career is looked at and say, I'm certain.
Okay. All right, and Peter, well, I'd just like to thank you very much indeed, and it's been a pleasure to have met you. Thank you.
Thank you.